Okay, I got another problem about if we're given a collection of subsets, do they determine the basis for a topology? And then further, is that topology one we're familiar with? So in our case here, what have we got so far? Let's take A to be the set of all reciprocals of natural numbers. So like 1, 1 half, 1 third, 1 fourth, etc. And we'll take the following collection of sets B, fancy B. I'll try to refer to it as fancy B, because I'm going to write some regular Bs that are not fancy later on. So fancy B here consists of two different types of sets. We're going to get all our kind of typical open intervals from A to B, where of course A is less than B, but A and B can be any real numbers. So again, if you thought about an open interval from like college algebra, there you go. What we're also going to do is we're going to throw in some of these kind of weirder sets where let's take those same open intervals, but let's go ahead and delete the stuff that's from A. So we'll delete all the reciprocals of natural numbers. And here again, you know, I'm using the minus sign as like set minus notation. Depending on what book you're looking at, maybe they use like a slash instead. All right, so we've got these two different types of sets here in this collection B. And what we want to do is we want to show that B is the basis for some topology, we'll call it T on R. And then the next thing that we want to do is try to determine, is the topology that B generates, is that topology the typical topology on R? Which it might seem at first glance like it might be because, well, hey, like those form a basis for the typical topology. So maybe you're thinking, yeah, of course it would be. So let's start with the first part though. Let's just try to show that collection does act as a basis for some topology, that we could use those as like the building blocks for some topology T. So remember how that goes. I've already done one video about this with the lower limit topology. So go check that out if you want some more practice with this. But there's typically two things that we look for. So to show that fancy B is a basis for some topology on the real line, you need to show one, that the real line, which is, you know, kind of our parent set, that it's equal to the union of all such basis elements. So in other words, that like the basis elements cover the space that you're interested in. So how we're going to do this is sort of like a typical subset kind of proof. Let's let X be a real number, and we're going to show that X is contained in one of these Bs, therefore any X is contained in at least one of these Bs, and so of course you get that the reals are contained in the union of all such Bs. All right, so if X is any real number, then why don't we just take B, regular B, to be the interval x minus 1 to x plus 1, so that x is definitely in there, it's in the middle. And so such a set is in fancy B, right? Such a set has this form right here, which we said is a part of fancy B. So that's pretty cool, that contains x. So what have we shown? Just that one, there's two sentences, I guess there's one, two sentences here. That shows that for each real number x, of course you could find an element of your proposed basis of fancy B such that x is contained in B. I don't know where that x part went. It's gone there. It's supposed to be an x right there though, but you get it. So what does that show then? Since you could do that for any arbitrary real number, that says that the real line must be a subset of the union on these Bs. Of course, the reverse inequality here is kind of obvious since R is your ambient set in this problem. So you get the equality. So those two sets are equal. Therefore, number one up here, satisfied. Number two is usually the trickier thing. What do we want to show? If you had two basis elements, B1 and B2, and if you had an element X that's in the intersection of B1 and B2, then what we need to do is we need to show that there exists another basis element B, which doesn't have a subscript, such that X is in that B, and also that B is contained in the intersection of B1 and B2. So there's kind of like a smaller basis element that contains X and is also contained in the intersection of those two basis elements, B1 and B2. So again, it's a little bit trickier, but what are we going to do? So how we read this, if this good stuff happens, so like that's your hypothesis here. That's what you're going to play with. So that's what we ought to suppose right here. So let's say B1 and B2 are in our set fancy B, and let's say that X is some element that's in the intersection. And the way that we're going to do this is we're just going to look at three cases. So case one, you know, based on, what are the cases based upon, of course? Well, the cases are based upon what do B1 and B2 look like? You know, it's going to have maybe a form like this. I'm going to kind of condense it down to, it's either a basis element that looks like maybe A to B, or maybe it's a basis element where it looks like that open interval, but we're going to delete, again, like 1 over n for each natural number n. Okay, so if we keep those cases in mind, the first case might be the easiest one. What if you just had two kind of legit open intervals where you're not deleting any reciprocals of anything? In that case then, what we're also going to do to make this a little bit easier, and also to the other arguments are pretty similar to what I'm about to do, so I'm going to use this phrase without loss of generality. Let's just go ahead and assume that A is less than C, is less than B, is less than D. And so if you look at this, that means that we're going to assume there's some overlap between the two sets. So that's kind of the interesting case here. And of course, I know that there's supposed to be some overlap between these two sets because, you know, by assumption, X is in the intersection of the two. So that's why I claim the main idea is just kind of thinking about this case or this idea about how the A's, C's, B's, and D's are aligned. This gives you kind of the picture of what's going to happen later. All right. So what should we do then? Remember, our goal is to find some other basis element that contains X and is contained in the intersection of these two things. And maybe what you notice is, well, okay, if A is less than C, less than B, less than D, what happens when I just take the intersection of these two? Well, in that case, you just get the interval from C to B, right? So C is to the left of B there. So again, just take B to be that interval from C to B. This guy C to B, it's got the same form as B1 and B2, therefore it's certainly a basis element. It definitely contains X since it's in both of them there. And also, since it's the intersection, I mean, this subset here is really an equal to. So we'll just kind of relax that and say, well, it's a non-proper subset, B1 and B2. So it's equal to it. Anyway, that's the first case. So we've come up with such a B. So what are the other cases? Again, they're just based on maybe what would B1 and B2 look like as far as basis elements go, or as far as elements of our set fancy B go. So the next case is, well, what if B1 is kind of a nice open set interval from A to B, but then what if B2 is one of these goofy things where I take my open interval from C to D, but I delete those reciprocals and natural numbers. So what should we do in this case? Well, we'll do the same kind of thing. Again, let's assume that we had some intersection between these two things, since by hypothesis, that's what we are assuming here. So let's just kind of write this configuration down. The other arguments are similar based on how these are arranged, where you can ensure there is some intersection. So let's just look at this case, A less than C, less than B, less than D. In that case, the same kind of thing there, all right? So if you have this configuration, when you actually just take straight up the overlap of these two things, you still ought to just get the interval from C to B here, but then what else are we doing? Well, I don't want anything that is of the form 1 over n, so we should still just delete the same stuff. So again, what is the set B that you should take that is going to solve this little part of the problem for us? Again, it should still just be the intersection. Just the intersection of these two happens to do the thing that I want it to do as far as how we determine if we've got a basis. So in that case, again, B is definitely looks like one of those elements of fancy B. X is definitely an element of this B. And then this B is, in fact, equal to B1 intersect B2. So the last case we're going to consider is, what if both the basis elements we're considering are these kind of goofy ones where you delete the reciprocal is 1 over n? And in that case, well, it's been working this up to now. Let's just keep doing it. So without loss of generality, let's assume that we've got this configuration where A is less than C is less than B is less than D. And again, that's just one configuration to ensure that we've got some overlap between these two, which we know that we have by hypothesis. And so again, let's just take B to be the intersection of these two sets, right? When you intersect these, you should still just end up with, well, the interval from C to B, but still just delete all the stuff from A. Still just delete all the reciprocals 1 over N. So again, the straight up intersection of these two happens to be the plane B that solves the problem for us. So again, B looks like one of our sets in fancy B, X is in B now, and then B is in fact equal to, one more time, the intersection of these two. Great. And so that exhausts all the possibilities maybe for what our B1s and B2s and all that good stuff look like, kind of reducing to the case where we're just looking at kind of the basic form of these basis elements. And so what have we shown? We've shown B satisfies those two requirements so that it's definitely a basis for some topology T. So we'll call the topology T that this basis B is associated to. It's definitely the basis for some topology T on R. All right, so the next part of the problem we want to consider is the topology T that we discovered above, is it actually just the usual topology on the real line? And the answer to that is a big red no. So how come? So what we're going to do is we're going to walk through how would you show that maybe two different bases generate different topologies. In other words, what we're going to try to do is show that the two bases that we have are not equivalent, therefore they don't generate the same topology. So recall that the usual topology we could take as a basis for it B prime, and we'll just take it as just the regular old open intervals, parentheses on both sides, A to B, A, B, or any real numbers that you like, as long as A is less than B. So what we're going to do is we're going to find an element of real, we're going to find a specific real number, and we're going to find a specific set from our basis above B, which remember, just to remind you way up here, B was all these kind of usual open sets, but we're also throwing in this possibility that the usual open sets deleting the reciprocals and natural numbers here. So we're gonna find a specific one of these such that the following things happen. Such that there is no just typical open set B prime, right? B prime lives in here, that's what I mean by typical open set, that contains that X, but is also contained in our set B here. So again, we're gonna find a specific real number and a specific kind of weird open set in B such that no regular kind of open interval contains this number X and also is contained in our weird kind of open set B. So what are we gonna do? Why don't we let B be the interval from -1 to 1 minus A. So that's definitely a member of fancy B, right? So we're just taking this interval and deleting all the reciprocals of natural numbers here. And note that x equals 0, well, that's still a good element of regular b here, right? I'm not taking 0 to be a natural number in case that's not clear. So 0 is still an element of this set b here. Now what we're going to do is we're going to think about, well, let's take any just kind of regular open interval that also contains 0. You know, 0 is the limit of that sequence 1 over n, right? As n gets large, those fractions 1 over n go to 0. And so in that case, this interval, if 0 is in it, then in fact it should contain infinitely many of these fractions that look like 1 over n, where n's a natural number. I'm not saying it has all of them, but I'm saying that it does have infinitely many. Maybe it has from like 1/9 onward, right? You know that you could find a natural number so that 1 over n is always in there for all such n that are large enough. All right, so let's think about what just happened then. So it's impossible then for just kind of a regular open interval from A to B to contain x equals 0, but to also be a subset of B here, right? So in that case, what we just showed is that any open interval has to have some stuff from A in it. So therefore, it's not possible that the interval from A to B could be contained in this B, right? So if you think about that containment one more time, if the containment was true, if there wasn't a slash through it here, that would mean that like, the interval from A to B, it should miss some of these reciprocals and natural numbers, but of course it doesn't, because we talked about 0 is the limit of that sequence 1 over n. So all, for n large enough, they should all be in there. All right, so what did we just show? We just showed that we found kind of a goofy open set in our basis fancy B here that doesn't contain any kind of regular open interval that we're used to from like college algebra. And so that is enough to show that B, fancy B and fancy B prime, where fancy B prime is the basis for the usual topology on R, that these two things are not equivalent bases. And I think I mentioned it earlier, that is enough to guarantee that these two sets, B, fancy B and fancy B prime, that they don't generate the same topologies. Therefore, T, the topology generated by fancy B prime, or, I'm sorry, T is the topology generated by fancy B, is not the same thing as the usual topology, which is generated by fancy B prime.